Where is Palantir going? Can it make us rich or broke? What's the market's mood at the moment, and what is or what should be the best approach going forward? Hi everyone, I hope that you had an amazing day and lots of profitable trades. In this video, we're going to talk about Palantir and see if it's the right stock for you. As we know, over the past few years, things haven't been looking great in the job market. Companies once considered as safe havens for those looking for gainful employments have been reducing their workforce and sometimes cutting entire departments or branches, so it's been a traumatizing experience for many of us concerned. At the same time, the rapidly rising inflation has been eating people's savings away in many parts of the world that have only known deflation until then. When every single assumption about what the real life should be is getting blurry, we gotta seize that opportunity to start working on ourselves and towards our own financial independence. One key factor to improve our financial situation is finding the growth opportunities of tomorrow, and seize the ones that may multiply our capital exponentially, increasing our capital available for subsequent projects. Essentially, we gotta find the golden goose, and for many, Palantir is exactly what we're looking for. Over the past few years, it became so much more than just another tech stock asking for your money in exchange for blue skies. It has grown into a major player in the sector that may tell us a lot about what's the market demand for speculative ventures and risk. The company has a lot of clout and prestige to arouse the market's curiosity, as well as people's tendency to follow popular trends. It is a company that people would often view equally as the risk appetite measurement of the market alongside others like Tesla or Nvidia. Palantir's reactivity to the macroeconomic tidal waves makes it a very interesting company to analyze and sometimes to invest in as well. In this video, we're going to take a deep dive into Palantir and to see whether it deserves to have a place in your portfolio. Before the video continues, I just want to take a moment to thank you for coming to my channel and hope that you will enjoy your stay and to come back for more content. If you like what you see, please consider to like, subscribe, and check out my channel for playlists of companies I cover. With that being said, I hope you're going to enjoy today's video, and let's get started. Over the past few days, Palantir has been able to climb to around $26, while the market remained mostly uneventful, all things considered. Palantir has been able to take a break and to consolidate while maintaining itself above the $25 level, which is crucial. And the market is now mostly in vacation mode for to embrace itself for a potentially more eventful autumn. Over the course of past few months, despite an absence of significant catalysts, the drift of summer trading volume and the previous attempts to push Palantir lower, Palantir's price action has been able to hold itself above the $20 level while looking for consolidation. Some additional reasons may include the upcoming rebalance of S&P 500 and a doubt of Palantir's capacity to maintain its growth rate in public contracts. These elements may be enough for many shareholders to take profits while waiting for a better entry point. Some may also believe that the short selling can be a good idea given the price action's pullbacks. Due to the nature of the shareholder base, Palantir is a stock that's mostly made of momentum and a large dose of anticipation as well as self-fulfilling prophecy, instead of cash flows and financial results. The fact that its actual financial results are decent could be important, but not enough to support its current valuations, let alone pushing it to higher levels. We can see that its widening scope, if anything, has grabbed the market's attention far more than anything else from its own financial statements. So far, the resistance turned support levels have been identified at first at 20 and then 25, above which the new goals are to surpass the $30 and maybe the $35. With the support levels between $20 and $23, it kind of provides a lot of stability for anyone who wants to short sell Palantir. These levels serve as important markers for investors, indicating a potential area for price rebound if things were to pull back once again. The short-term trend of Palantir stock appears to be bullish. The previous decrease in both interest and volume from investors are now old stories. While the overall trend stayed bullish, the short-term weakening momentum did not transform itself into larger market sell-offs. Now, in terms of volume, the stock sees a trading volume that is around 18 million shares per day and peaked at around 50 million shares, with a 30-day average volume of around 30 million shares as well. What this means is that we're probably witnessing a stabilizing demand around 20 to 30 million shares on a daily basis. Palantir has experienced a period of uncertainty where the failed attempts to reach $25 saw a profit-taking and price pullbacks from 25 to 21, when an increasing number of articles popped up questioning the relevance and the sustainability of the Palantir surge at the time. This was likely the reason why back then the price made a pullback. And the current news is that Palantir has increased its spectrum of services offered. So this is what has pushed Palantir's price to make a comeback. From a longer term perspective, I would say that Palantir has a very interesting price action pattern compared to the all-time highs a few years ago. It is basically sitting at the same plateau back in 2021 during the period of uncertainty that eventually led to a sell-off. On a fundamental level, Palantir has always gathered a lot of attention from retails ever since it went IPO. This could in fact be one of its potential weaknesses because it kind of also shows with the flip side of the coin that institutional investors hesitate before becoming the majority shareholders and owners of Palantir's equity. This could be a sign that despite its solid business model and reliable revenue streams, Palantir is too expensive for those who manage other people's money. This increased presence of retails also explains why Palantir tends to be a bit more volatile than other stocks of a similar size. Ever since its debut in the secondary market, the sentiment has been very reactive, either bullish or bearish, with investors eager to capitalize on all the trends and momentums, including the company's innovative data analytics technology on the way up and the wider tech sell-off, as well as high interest rates last year or the year before on the way down. Obviously, Palantir's journey has been characterized by intermittent periods of, I would say, overreactions by the market, sometimes pushing it above a level that's clearly unsustainable back in 2021, and then dipping below $10 back in 2022 and part of 2023. One significant aspect of Palantir's price movement is the correlation between its fundamentals and the macroeconomic news cycles. Geopolitical uncertainties, supply chain issues, questioning or weakening demands, election results, and interest rate decisions, as well as regulations or narratives around AI, data, or technologies in general may have large impacts on share prices, while simultaneously being affected by the company's own news about the financial performances as well as guidance. The relevance of analyzing news, however, should be limited. It's often observed that the news surrounding the company reflects what the price action already shows, leading to a self-fulfilling prophecy scenario. When the stock is on an upward trajectory, the news will quickly correct themselves to dominate the headlines with positive stories, which are going to fuel the existing optimism even further. And then on the flip side of the coin, during downturns, we're going to have a lot of negative news that's going to amplify the existing fear, accelerating the downward trend. It goes for most stocks that we might be interested in, but it's just more obvious with Palantir. The news articles may be interesting to confirm if the wind is currently blowing in the direction you think it's blowing, but not to tell us about the future direction. As things currently stand at the moment, Palantir has been able to maintain its bullish trend in the medium and long run, albeit with diminishing marginal increase and occasional pullbacks over the short term. The stock has shown resilience in the recent sessions. The pace of its ascent has slowed, indicating a potential shift in sentiment amongst investors. There's a growing need for additional catalysts to sustain the bullish momentum and to propel the stock to new heights. Something that can really influence Palantir's future performance is its status as a large cap. When market cap increases, Palantir might be poised to solidify its position amongst the market leaders as part of a self-fulfilling prophecy, as more market participants would like to spread some of their existing risks into large companies perceived as blue chips. Large cap status often brings increased institutional interest and a broader investor base, both of which could contribute to further upside potentials. Despite the current bullish outlook, it's essential to exercise caution, especially in the short run. The price targets of $30 to $35 is realistic. It even seems plausible, given its growth prospects and the market positioning, but they're of course not guaranteed. A lot of things can move very quickly, especially in today's investment environment. The factors from multiple aspects do suggest that we still have an overall bullish outlook, supported by its recent performance, as well as the long-term outlook and potentials. Regarding the financial performances, I would say that it's one of Palantir's strong suit, and it's enough to keep the stock above a certain baseline. It already has been through a period of massive sell-off back in 2022. The rock bottom might be, in theory, around $10. With that being said, it's something to keep an eye on since the financial reports are known to, you know, move the numbers around on the charts. The key levels I look at are the cash levels, the gross margin, and the growth. The cash levels will tell us if the company will come back to us and need to dilute the shareholders in order to bring more cash in. This typically happens if a tech company, I say tech company because it mostly happens with the speculative ventures on the NASDAQ. So these companies will tell you, look, the market is very promising. We are on the cusp of yet another industrial revolution or what have you. But in the meantime, we need some additional money. Could you please provide this to us? Now, once they say that, it's like, you know, either you do this or all your existing investment goes up the flame. So this is why a lot of people would pour in new capital into this company, while de facto they're accepting sucking up a part of loss. And because Palantir doesn't have this problem, this is one of the issues. This is one of the things that makes Palantir a very interesting company to put your money into, because you don't have to worry about dilutions for that reason. And then the gross margins. Gross margins has been crucial earlier on because it kind of shows us that the business model would work as long as it has enough scale and if we're patient enough. And I believe that Palantir's shareholders have been relatively patient, all things considered. The last one is a bit trickier, is a lot trickier in fact, is the growth level. So it's one thing to be good right now, it's quite another to be good forever, to keep growing at the current pace forever. So recently, I think that one of the key reasons why Palantir went from 21 to like 20, sorry, from 25 to 21, arguably it's because the company said, you know, their public contracts have been slowing down the growth. Not saying that they're making less money from the contracts, they're just growing more slowly compared to their anticipation. And that has caused a sell-off. So it kind of shows you what may influence the outcomes on like the price charts. So given its symbolic and size-related significance, investing in Palantir certainly comes with its unique set of opportunities and challenges. So there are different levels of considerations to go through when you make that decision on putting your money into Palantir. The main reason why people want to go in is the growth potential, or the supposed growth potential. In other words, we don't want to invest in the Palantir that currently is. We want to invest into the Palantir to become. It's often positioned and considered as the market's leader in terms of like data analytics. It operates in a field with a lot of promise for the future of the economy, because businesses will rely increasingly on data-driven insights to improve their decision-making. Companies like Palantir are well positioned to capitalize on this trend, and with its expertise in handling and analyzing large volumes of data, it stands to benefit from the growing demand for data-centric solutions across various industries. So Palantir's own financial stability is also a reassuring factor for investors. It's not like many other tech startups. Palantir has established a lot of revenue generating streams. So its business model is in profit. It reduces the likelihood for share dilutions, like I said previously, providing investors with a very much needed sense of stability and confidence into the company's own financial health. Additionally, Palantir has demonstrated its ability to capitalize on popular trends to generate significant interest in the market, especially amongst retail traders. Like, when it says that it's going to enter into the AI, it attracted a lot of attention from individual and institutional investors. This ability to capture the market sentiment and leverage it, and to like leverage that to its own advantage, also kind of underscores Palantir's potential for growth and success in the long run. In terms of challenges, the most obvious one would be legal challenges. It deals with data. It deals with something that's pretty sensitive in terms of what should belong to whom and who can use it to do what. So Palantir handles the data, but do they actually always have the right to handle them? Or do we always know who should be handling them, or who should just be asking this question, right? If there are any lawsuits going on, that might like significantly impact Palantir's potentials and its profitability. The second portion is the growth, or its heavy dependence on the public contracts. So of course Palantir has private clients as well, but its main cash cow is like the public contracts. If that's the case, then what if one day the government no longer has the money to spend? What if one day we're in a recession? So if they ever tell the analysts that they're not going to be growing as fast, doesn't mean that, you know, the current assumption about Palantir's future should be recalculated in the form of difference in the market cap. If that is the case, then this might be a major risk for Palantir, because remember, it is a company that's built on momentums about the future. It's not really a company that's built around the current glories or the current performances. We know that it's making money, but that's not why it's trading at where it's trading at. So this is also something to consider. And also, you should always be looking for some kind of narrative shift. What I mean is, what is popular today may not be popular tomorrow. We can look at fintech, we can look at EV, and then we can look at AI and, I would say, data. Does it mean that whatever that's popular today will remain popular tomorrow? That is a
So right now, the global markets are facing a complex interplay of factors that have the potential to significantly influence the equities worldwide. In this speculative analysis, I believe that the consequences of the global inflation, surging commodity prices, and declined quantitative easing, as well as the rise of inflation rates or interest rates, plus the geopolitical instabilities, are going to play a significant part. The increasing inflation rate has been putting pressures across the globe, threatening the purchasing power, raising the input costs, and impacting corporate profitability. Companies operating internationally may face challenges in managing rising production costs and also to sustain profit margins. Those dynamics could trigger market volatility as investors adjust their risk-return expectations. The upward trajectory of commodity prices, including energy, metals, agricultural products, have been having far-reaching implications for various sectors of the global equities market. The companies heavily dependent on these commodities may experience squeezed profit margins, potentially affecting stock valuations and investor sentiment. The reduction or the end of QE's quantitative easing measures by the central banks worldwide may have resulted in reduced market liquidity. So this in turn could lead to higher borrowing costs for companies seeking capital, which may also discourage investment activities or will. The elevated market volatility plus the reduced investors' appetite may also continue to occur. Now, the central banks around the world are tackling this delicate situation of balancing the inflation rates with the economic stability and, if possible, growth. Central banks opted for aggressive interest rate hikes to combat inflation. Borrowing costs for companies have been rising, which has also slowed down business activities and also fueling the market's volatility in terms of the equity prices. Now, ongoing geopolitical tensions, including trade disputes, political uncertainties, and social unrest, will inject an additional element of volatility into the global markets. Investors may adopt a cautious approach, shifting towards safer assets, impacting the equities. Additionally, the escalating conflicts may disrupt supply chains, negatively impacting the performance of international companies. Given the interconnectedness of global markets, the aforementioned factors have reverberating effects on the U.S. equities market. Companies with significant exposure to international market may face a lot of headwinds resulting from the economic slowdowns, disrupting the supply chains and the currency fluctuations. But nevertheless, the U.S. market is known for its resilience, and the diverse sectors may attract investors seeking safe havens. So really, the current landscape is characterized by global inflation, surging commodity prices, reduced quantitative easing, rising central bank inflation rates, geopolitical instabilities, and also ongoing lack of certainty regarding growth. While the U.S. market may exhibit relative strength due to the safe haven status, it's going to remain interconnected with the global economic landscape. For long-term investors, these conditions may offer opportunities to identify undervalued companies with strong fundamentals and international diversification. That being said, short-term trades should be approached with caution because of the increased volatility and uncertainty. And also, we should be careful when assessing individual companies, sectors, or regions.
Alright, so with all that being said, what should be our overall plan about Palantir? I think that in the long run, Palantir is definitely something that should be included in anyone who wants to have some sort of risk-taking or risk exposure into data, AI, and more broadly speaking, NASDAQ. It is one of those companies that has remained active even when NASDAQ itself as a whole was like mostly bearish. Yeah, you may see the all-time high, but if you remove NVIDIA from the lot, is it still that bullish? I kind of doubt it. So, because Palantir is another one of those very actively traded stocks, even when times were tough, just imagine when capital becomes more available. So this is one thing to consider. In the short run, is it a good stock to pick? My personal opinion is you can buy some if you fear the FOMO. You can buy some to basically appease to yourself and then to gradually DCA in over the course of the next 12 to 18 months. The maximum exposure should be between 8 to 10% of your portfolio.